ओके, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। मैं ऑडिबल?
गुड मॉर्निंग सर। यस सर, गुड मॉर्निंग।
मॉर्निंग। कैन यू सी द कैन यू सी द स्लाइड स्टूडेंट्स? इज इट विजिबल?
यस सर।
ओके ओके। In the last class, we had discussed about the two different types of pipelining protocols, and we have understood what is the difference among them, and what was the issue with the go back n, and how selective repeat addressed those issues. And we also got to know that these sequence number restrictions with the selective repeat, that means, say for example, if you start with the sequence number 0 1 2 3, and start again from 0 0 1 2 3 0 1 2 3, if you go on like that with the sequence number repeating one by one, so it may get you into some conflicts. So that also have some difficulties. Hence we moved to TCP, where that address the problem which we have faced with respect to selective repeat. So I have taught you the structure of TCP, and I have given few hints about how TCP works. Let me again repeat it quickly. So you can see here, TCP is a point-to-point protocol. So point-to-point in the sense there will be one sender and one receiver. It will be reliable. It's a reliable protocol. Reliable in the sense you can have a guarantee that whatever the data you have transferred has reached the destination. And at least if it has not reached, you will get that information so that you can retransmit. Okay, you will have a track of whatever you are doing. And in order byte stream, that means what are the packets that you send, in what order you send, in the same order it will reach the destination. Or even if it doesn't reach the destination with the same order, destination has the ability to arrange it in an order and then give it to the application. Okay, then TCP is completely based on pipelined protocols. Okay, so pipeline, we already know, we are not going to work with respect to stop and wait. Okay, so stop and wait is basically you send one packet and wait for its acknowledgement, and upon receiving the acknowledgement, send the next packet. That's not the case here. You in the pipeline, you can send 10 packets, 15 packets, 20 packets, 100 packets. It depends on how it is like configured. Okay, so TCP congestion and flow control set window size. Okay, so there is a window size in the TCP which tells you how many packets you have to put in the pipeline at a time. That will inform you like whether receiver is ready, how much amount of packets the receiver is ready to receive. Congestion is basically in between source and destination. If you have any congestion in any of the router, that router itself will give the information to the TCP a sender. Okay, and there is another way. There is another way also where sender can get to know that there is congestion in the network. We will discuss about that later. That's about pipeline. Then full duplex. TCP is full duplex communication. That means TCP can a sender with TCP can send and also receive at the same time. Okay, it's bidirectional data flow in the same connection. Keep that in mind, students. So whatever we have discussed till now, like RDTs 1.0 to 3.0, and the two pipeline protocols, that is go back and selective repeat, we have discussed only with respect to half duplex communication. Okay, so TCP is full duplex communication, and there is a maximum segment size. MSS is maximum segment size. That means how much amount of data that you can send in a particular segment, there is a limitation for that, and that is called as or termed as MSS, maximum segment size. And TCP is connection oriented, very, very important. What do you mean by connection oriented? So basically, before sending the data, you will establish a connection with the receiver from the sender. So what it tells, it will exchange some parameters, some rules, like what should be the window size, what is the initial sequence number, all those things will be exchanged, and that process is called as handshaking. You can see here, it's a handshaking process, and it's also called as three-way handshake. I'll explain you why it is called as three-way handshake later. So you can see here exchange of control messages. That's what I told you in the handshaking process or connection connection setup phase. It is also called as connection setup phase. So there we will exchange some control messages. Okay. And then finally flow control. So I already told you what is flow control. Sender will not overwhelm the receiver. Okay, flow control is basically you will observe like whether receiver is ready to receive that amount of data or not. These are the major features of TCP, and you can see here RFC is like 793, 1122, 1323, 2018, and 2581. These are all just the updates. Initially it was 793, then it was updated to 112, 22. Like that, every update was recorded in a new RFC, and finally we have 2581 RFC. Is that clear? I said you in the previous classes also, like if you want to look into this protocol completely in detail, just go to Google and type RFC 793, RFC 2581. So it will give you the complete detail, the working procedure, the header size, everything, all information, header fields, every information will be there in that. Okay. So any questions regarding the features of TCP, students? Shall we go to the next slide? Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, can you tell me what is the difference between TCP and UDP? What are the major differences between TCP and UDP? It is very important for you to understand that. Can anyone tell me before we move further?
TCP is readable, UDP is unreadable.
Okay. Then, why UDP is unreliable?
It will not wait for the acknowledgement. No acknowledgement like this. Acknowledgements are not.
Okay, there are no acknowledgements in UDP, which makes UDP as unreliable. And there is no connection establishment phase in UDP. Is that clear? There is no connection establishment at all. It will directly send the packet. Whether the receiver is ready to receive it or not, it's not the case. Okay. Anything else? What are the other differences that you observe? Yes, can anyone tell me the other differences? Just by looking into the header structure itself, you can say what are the differences.
Sir, TCP is connection oriented protocol and UDP is datagram oriented protocol.
Is what you said is right, but it is not called as datagram oriented. When you say TCP as connection oriented, UDP is connectionless. Okay, that's how it is termed.
Okay, yes, sir. Yes, yes, sir.
TCP is connection oriented, UDP is connectionless protocol. Then, see, keep in mind, students, connection oriented and connectionless doesn't have any relation with wired and wireless. Okay, many will get that confusion. Wired and wireless is a totally different thing. Okay, both UDP and TCP supports wired and wireless. So connection and connection establishment, connection oriented and connectionless, there is nothing to do with wired and wireless. Okay, keep that in mind. Then what else?
So UDP is faster and it has loss tolerance, data loss tolerance.
TCP is more yes. Reliable, UDP is not reliable, TCP is reliable. Okay, and one more point the other guy said, it's very important. UDP is loss tolerant. That means, say for example, when you are working with a video conferencing, if you lose one or two frames, what are videos when you are you will be receiving or sending multiple frames or images continuously, like per second you will be sending around hundreds of thousands of images which will appear to you as a video. So in that case, if you lose one or two frames, one or two images, that doesn't create any big problem for your communication, right? It's a simple thing. So right, do you agree with that, students? It doesn't create any issue. So that's one reason why we use UDP for video conferencing or any other multimedia applications. The other reason is if you use TCP for every packet, generally you need to expect acknowledgement. Say for example, pipeline or cumulative acknowledgements. So what happens if you don't receive the acknowledgement after some set of packets are sent in a pipeline? If you don't receive acknowledgement, you have to retransmit that. So, but in video conferencing, if you do that way, if you work that way in video conferencing, don't you think there will be a huge delay or lag in your communication? So that's why there are categories of applications where even if there is some kind of a loss, your communication will continue. The application should tolerate it. So that's why for those kind of applications, we use UDP. So UDP is called as loss tolerant application. Because UDP doesn't require any acknowledgement or any other reliable services. So that's one major difference between TCP and UDP. UDP is loss tolerant, whereas TCP is not loss tolerant. And since UDP is loss tolerant and there is no connection establishment phase in UDP, UDP will be faster, obviously, because even the header size of the UDP is very less compared to TCP. Okay, so what differences we have seen till now? TCP is reliable, UDP is unreliable. TCP is not loss tolerant, UDP is loss tolerant. TCP is quite slow compared to UDP. Then what is the other difference, students? TCP provides congestion control and flow control mechanism, whereas UDP doesn't provide congestion control and flow control mechanism. TCP have connection establishment phase and connection teardown phase, where UDP doesn't have connection establishment and connection teardown phase. Okay, so these are a few major differences between TCP and UDP. If you have any other difference in your mind, you can let me.
UDP sends out of order the data.
Yes, I agree.
And also UDP, as you said, it's faster, so it's rate sensitive.
You cannot say it as rate sensitive because, see, we use DNS, right, in application layer. DNS uses UDP as its underlying protocol, okay? So DNS is not a rate sensitive application or a protocol. So you cannot... Most of the services or most of the applications which use UDP are rate sensitive. I agree, but not all. Am I clear?
Okay, sir.
Okay. Anything else, students? Any other differences between?
So PDU, which takes TCP as the underlying protocol, is called a segment, whereas for UDP, it is called as datagram.
No. I didn't get you, actually. Can you please repeat?
Like the PDU is there, no, sir. Name of the PDU.
PDU of transport layer is called as what?
Yeah, if it is TCP, then it is called as segment. If it is UDP, it is called as datagram.
No. Don't have that confusion. It is with respect to layers, not with respect to the protocols which are used in that layer. Okay. In application layer, you have multiple protocols like HTTP, FTP, DNS. All the application layer messages, information is called as message. We don't have a difference in that. Similarly, in transport layer, whether you use UDP or TCP, it is called as segments. But when it comes to network layer, the below layer, then it is called as datagram. Okay, don't have that confusion. Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I hope we have listed a lot of differences, covered most of the differences now. Okay. So we'll move to the next this thing. Yeah. I have already discussed this with you, so I'm not going to discuss the segment structure again. So, but you need to know this segment structure very clearly because it's very important. And you also should know the difference. When you see, when you keep the segment structure of UDP next to your TCP segment structure, you can observe the header fields. There are a lot of header fields in TCP segment, whereas in UDP segment, the header fields are very less. That is one more reason why UDP is fast compared to TCP. Okay. Sequence numbers, we know how sequence numbers are generated in TCP, sequence numbers and byte stream. Numbers are first byte in the segment data. Okay. Sequence number will be the number of first byte in the segment. Okay. Say if there are n bytes, so 1 to 10 is first packet, that means sequence number of that will be 1. Then 11 to 20, if it is second packet, sequence number of that will be 11. Like that, it goes on. Okay. Acknowledgement, sequence number of next byte expected from other side. Is that clear? Yeah, it is acknowledgement number. Is that clear, students? That I have already told you. What is the next byte, next packets first expected? That will be the acknowledgement number of a packet. And then TCP works with cumulative acknowledgement. Okay, what do you mean by cumulative acknowledgement? Say, for example, you are sending say 5 packets from source to destination, and in a single pipe. After receiving the 5th packet, if the receiver sends only acknowledgement for the 5th packet, it is understood for the sender that whatever the packets that are sent before that, before 5th packet, everything has reached the destination properly. Okay. So for all these, don't send acknowledgement for every packet. Send only one acknowledgement after a few packets. So that is called as cumulative acknowledgement. Okay. So TCP follows cumulative acknowledgement structure. So so you can see here, if the window size, window size, if the window size is n, so sequence number space will be this much. So basically, yellow color, what you see is sent. Students, be online just a second. So you can see the yellow color packets here are sent but not yet acknowledged. That means they are in flight. They are sent but not yet acknowledged. Blue color, what you see is usable but not yet sent. Okay. And green color, what you see is already sent and also acknowledged. Okay. So the other color, what you see here, is not usable. That means this is the, this blue and yellow is the overall what I can say, the window size. Okay, sent not acknowledged, usable but not yet sent. Okay, this that's what it is seen here, window size. So that's the window size of sender, and sequence number varies from peer to peer. So yes, this is this diagram we were looking into it yesterday's class. Can you see the screen, students? Can you see the slide change?
Yes.
So host A and host B, user types C. So data is see what you are sending. Sequence number is 42 and acknowledgement number is 79. Post acknowledged the receipt C, echoes back C. So it again sending it. So data C, acknowledgement is 43 and sequence number is 79. So it's a telnet scenario. I think we will not get into this. It's not required for you as of now. So don't get confused with this, students, with the sequence number and acknowledgement number here. This is for the telnet scenario, okay? So let us forget it for now. Yeah, this is very important. TCP round trip time and timeout calculation. Okay, very, very important. TCP round trip time and timeout calculation. What do you mean by a round trip time, students? Can anyone tell me? What do you mean by round trip time?
Time taken by the packet to send to the receiver and get acknowledged.
Yes. So it's a round trip. You are going to somewhere and coming back from there. Okay, a packet goes from a source to destination and gets an acknowledgement, comes back. Okay, that is called as a round trip time. Okay, so when you we have come across something called as timer, right? When we discuss that in RDT 3.0, you send a packet and switch on your timer, and if you don't receive the acknowledgement within the timer runs out, so you will think that the packet has been lost and you will retransmit the packet. That's the scenario, right? But what is the timeout interval that you are going to decide? Any guess on that? What is the timeout interval? What should be your round trip time? And who is going to decide it? Whether it's constant for every packet or whether it is variable. So all those things we are going to discuss here now. So how to set a timeout value? Okay, that's the first question. How to set a timeout value? So longer than RTT, but RTT varies. Keep that in mind, students. RTT varies. So you have to keep the timer or timeout value, which should be longer than RTT. Okay. You will say, for example, when you do a handshaking process, you will figure out what should be the RTT. Okay. You will decide with the receiver what should be the RTT time. And you will get to know what is the RTT time. Based on that, you will decide the timeout value. Okay, based on that, you will decide the timeout value. And the timeout value should be always longer than RTT. Okay, it should not be equal to RTT or less than RTT. It should be always longer than RTT. But RTT varies. Why RTT varies? Let us see that. So what will you have? What will be the scenario if your timeout interval is too short? There might be premature timeout. Unnecessary retransmission may happen. That's the case with too short timeout interval. If it is too long, what happens? Slow reaction to segment loss. Okay, very slow reaction to segment loss will occur if the timeout interval is too long. So you have to keep a average timeout value, and that has to be decided very carefully. How to estimate RTT? Okay, how to set a TCP timeout value based on RTT? We know that we have to keep some value which is greater than RTT. But how to calculate RTT? I told you in the initial stage, some RTT will be calculated. Let us see how it will be calculated. So sample RTT, consider sample RTT, measured timeout, measured time from segment transmission until acknowledged receipt. Okay, the first packet, what you send initially, we will consider this as sample RTT. Okay, so measure time from segment transmission until acknowledgement is received. Ignore retransmissions. Okay, when you are calculating sample RTT, don't calculate the sample RTT for retransmitted packets. Okay, now sample RTT will vary. Want a estimated RTT smoother. Okay, so basically sample RTT, say for example you have sent 10 packets. So sample RTT, for every packet, if you try to find out the RTT, it varies. Okay, it happens because of the bandwidth, because of the latency, because of the throughput, it may vary. Okay, so average of several recent measurements, not just current sample RTT. Okay, so you have to take an average of these sample RTTs. had to take an average of the sample RTT, and then after calculating the sample RTT, the estimated RTT value, the estimated RTT value will be 1 minus alpha into estimated RTT plus alpha into sample RTT. We know what is sample RTT now? Exponential weighted moving average. It is called as exponential weighted moving average, EWMA. Okay, so influence of past sample decreases exponentially fast. So alpha value should be 0.125. Forget about this second point. What you have to understand is sample RTT, you know how to calculate. You have to find out estimated RTT. You have to take up a value for estimated RTT. Okay. So simple, old, some when you send a first packet, estimated RTT. So you have to calculate. Estimated RTT will be something. Then we have the sample RTTs. So to find out that, so you have to take an average of sample RTT. You can see here, estimated RTT will lie between many sample RTTs. Okay, it will be in between many sample RTTs. So this is how you calculate the estimated RTT value, and that is not the end. Okay, let me show you. What is timeout interval? So estimated RTT plus safety margin. So estimated RTT deviation from estimate sample RTT deviation from estimated RTT. So that is this one, students. So this is the sample RTT, the purple color line or the pink, what it is. This line. Sorry. This line, the purple color line. You should know that. Okay, so that should be added to calculate the timeout interval. Is that clear, sir? Estimated RTT plus this deviation RTT, what you have, this deviation from sample estimated RTT, what you have, that should be your timeout interval. Okay, timeout interval. So you have to calculate the deviation RTT will be 1 minus beta into deviation RTT plus beta into sample RTT minus estimated RTT. So typically beta value will be 0.25. Okay, this is just a set value. You don't worry about this. What you should know is what is alpha value and beta value. And so timeout interval will be estimated RTT. We know how to calculate estimated RTT plus 4 times of deviation RTT. Okay, this is the safety margin, not just one time. 4 times of deviation RTT should be added. This will be the safety margin, and that will be the timeout interval. Timeout interval will be estimated RTT plus 4 times of deviation RTT. Is it clear to you, students, about how to calculate RTTs, how to calculate, how to figure out what initial RTT, and with the help of RTT, you have to calculate the timeout interval. Is it clear to you? Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is this clear to you? Shall we go to the next topic?
Yes, sir.
The values will be in seconds, sir, this one.
Yes. Milliseconds generally. Okay. So let us see about reliable data transfer and what reliable data transfer is. So TCP creates RDT services, that is reliable data transfer services, on top of IP's unreliable service. That means you have network, you have transport layer, and below that you have network layer. Okay. In the transport layer, if you are using TCP, it provides you reliable data transfer. Okay. On top of what? On top of network layer. Basically, network layer will have IP in it, and IP is completely unreliable. Okay. So that's the meaning here. TCP creates RDT service on top of IP's unreliable service. Okay, it uses pipelined segments, cumulative acknowledgments, single retransmission timer. Okay, so retransmission triggered by timeout intervals or duplicate acknowledgments. We know that when retransmission happens, when the timeout occurs, or if you get a duplicate acknowledgement, if you are waiting for some acknowledgement but you get something else, okay, in that case you will do retransmission. Let's initially consider simplified TCP sender. Ignore duplicate acknowledgements, ignore flow control and congestion control. Let us see if all these are not there, what will be the initial condition. Okay, data is, you create a segment with sequence number. Think of timer as for oldest unacknowledged segment. So expiration interval will be timeout interval. We know that how to calculate timeout interval. So timeout, retransmit segment that caused timeout, or and also when there is a timeout session, you have to retransmit the segment which caused the timeout, and you have to restart the timer there. You just don't retransmit and sit quiet. You have to restart the timer, because again, if you have to restart the timer. Okay, so once you receive an acknowledgement, what you are supposed to do, if acknowledge the previous unacknowledged segments, so update what is known to be the acknowledged, start timer if there is a still unacknowledged segments. The same thing, whatever I have told you, it is put up here in a slide. Okay, so TCP sender, this is a work for you. You have to go through these diagram, students, and come back to me later. Okay, so I'm not going to discuss this diagram now. So retransmission scenario, what happens when there is a retransmission scenario? There is a good example here. So you have host A and host B. So host A is sending a packet with sequence number 92 and 8 bytes of data, and you are expected to receive an acknowledgement. It should be 100, acknowledgement 100, because 92 plus 8 will be 100. So now what happens? That acknowledgement is lost. The scenario is lost acknowledgement. The acknowledgement is lost, and after the timeout session, you are going to retransmit the packet again. So what happens when there is a premature timeout? Okay, so you are sending two packets, but you are expected to receive an acknowledgement before this, at least here, but you have not received it. So what you are going to do, you are going to retransmit that packet again. Okay, so in both premature and loss of acknowledgement, you are going to, loss of acknowledgement or loss of packet, you are going to retransmit the packet. Okay, so these are the retransmission scenarios. And there is one more, yeah, cumulative acknowledgement. So sequence number 92 with 8 bytes, sequence number 100 with 20 bytes, you are sending in a pipeline. So the acknowledgement for first packet is lost, but the acknowledgement for second packet is received. That is sufficient. This is what the cumulative acknowledgement means, students. If you receive an acknowledgement for the second packet before receiving the acknowledgement for the first packet, it is understood by the for the sender that the previous packet also have been received by host B. That's the reason why you can see it is sending packet with sequence number 120. It's not going to retransmit this packet, so that the acknowledgement for this is lost. Is it clear, students? So say for example, if this packet itself is lost, the host B is not going to send this acknowledgement at all. Retransmit. If acknowledgement last, and if you get a cumulative acknowledgement, you are not going to retransmit. So event at receiver, what happens? Arrival of in order segments with expected sequence number, all data up to expected sequence already acknowledged. Okay, so TCP receiver action, delayed ACK, wait up to 500 milliseconds for next segment. If no next segment, send acknowledgement. Okay, arrival of in order, the things whatever I have told you, it is put up in a table here. Just go through this, give you 2 minutes. Just go through this, students. And if you have any questions regarding this till now, whatever we have discussed in TCP, you can ask me. Okay, is it clear, students? Any doubts in this or in the topics which I covered now? Okay, so the next topic is TCP fast retransmit. So let me discuss this in the next class. So if you have any doubts now, you can have a discussion and clear it. Any doubts, students? Do you have any doubts?
Sir, can you explain that retransmission once again?
With the diagram or what?
Yes, sir. Like.
See here, in the last acknowledgement scenario, in this acknowledgement is lost. Okay. So what happens if there is only one packet in the pipe? So you will wait until the timeout runs out. Timeout happens, then you are going to retransmit it. Okay, so here in this scenario, it's a premature timeout. That means not the packet is lost, not the acknowledgement is lost, but it is going to come little late after the timeout. Even in that case also, you will end up in retransmitting the packet. Is that clear? It is called as premature timeout. So the other one is, here you have sent two packets, and the acknowledgement for the first packet is lost in between. Whereas within the timeout interval, if you receive acknowledgement for the second packet, it is understood for the sender that the first packet also has reached the destination properly. There might be some issue with the acknowledgement. That's all. So it is not going to retransmit. It is just going to send the next packet. You can observe here. First packet is 92 with 8 bytes. Second packet is 100 with 20 bytes. So it is going to send next packet, that is 120 with 15 bytes. Okay. Am I clear to you? These three scenarios, and this is called as cumulative.
Yes.
Am I clear, students? Any questions?
Sir, I remember Ulla sir saying for if we ping to google.com, there is 17 different routers in between. So similarly for acknowledgement also, there will be 17 different routers in between. But
yes,
it is not always that the routers are fixed, no sir. So there will be some time delays, or we won't be getting that acknowledgement in a particular time.
In what way a packet has been received, in the same way, in the same route, acknowledgement also will come. Say, for example, you are sending 10 packets from host A to host B, and 5 packets will go from an route, and other 5 packets go from another route. So the 5 packets which has come and for those 5 packets, acknowledgement will be sent to the same route, from the same route which it has come. Okay. But of course, yes. The time, there might be difference. There might be difference. It is not that the packet you have sent the RTT by 2, it will not be exactly RTT by 2. Okay. So you send a packet to the destination, it may take 5 seconds, but for the acknowledgement, it may say take only 2 seconds. Okay.
Okay, sir. Yeah.